Welcome to our Autumn Wreath Leaf. This is a really fairly simple project. I was actually really surprised as I was putting it together. Base coat, a little dry rubbing, spattering, a little bit of wheat technique, and you're done. It's a really great celebration of autumn and all the colors, and a lot of fun to do. The nice thing about the wreath is it's reversible. Okay, now I paint on one side only because if I display it shows, you can't see both sides. I've got the spring wreath already began. That's coming at a future date. So what's neat is for the price of one surface, you get two surfaces, and with only two surfaces, you can have four seasons of wreaths. For your door, you can tie a pretty bow and you can hang it on a wreath holder that makes, you know, that stands next to your fireplace or whatever. So it's very versatile. And then to make it kind of exciting, we come up with an idea. It's a little hard to get this guy on. It's got notes written up there. This is a magnet, and I've got magnet paint on here. So that's magnet paint, and then I've got chalkboard paint. So wham, wham, now I can write my notes. Got a little piece of chalk right here. Buy milk. Okay, so you can write on it, you can erase it. It's very durable, it's a wonderful surface. But what I did, and if I did this again, I would put, well, when I do this again, I would put two pieces of Velcro because I'm having a little bit of an issue with them rocking. But I just took little guys like this, and I just Velcroed them to the surface. So now I have a perpetual chalkboard. So what I can do is I can take another surface, like something a little bit longer, and I can do another season or flowers or whatever I want to on it. Then I can put Velcro on the back in the same position, and now I can change out my chalkboard. It can stay in one spot in my house, but it is now decorated for the seasons. We've added these little knobs down here for dog leashes and keys and things like that. You could put it in a bedroom, put bedroom type art on it, and have it serve, you know, all over the house. So that's our new project. I hope you enjoy it. This is a neat way of making it be a quicker project, or if you want to do the whole thing, then you can do the wreath. And both are included on the same DVD. We're creating a perpetual chalkboard, and you'll see what I mean when we get going, but the idea is that the chalkboard's going to stay the same, and then we're going to add these little elements onto the front of them that are painted that you can change, so that you can keep the chalkboard the same, but change out the art for the season, so it becomes a perpetual chalkboard. But what we're going to do is we're going to make it a perpetual magnetic chalkboard. First thing I want to do is use DecoArt Americana All-Purpose Sealer. It's a great general all-purpose sealer. You can use it for metals and just like basically all surfaces. Plastic would be the one that I would really hesitate to use it with, but the paint adhesion medium works really great with plastic. So I just want to seal all the sides just to make sure that I don't get any warpage, if I get exposure to water or anything like that. So I'll seal it and allow it to dry completely. Now what I love about, this is obviously not my calendar, but we're gonna start on our wreath. These wreaths can be flipped over and you can paint the back sides as well. So I love that I can have a spring project which I've got started on the front, and then I can flip it over and I have my fall right on the back. So I only need to buy one piece of wood for two seasons, so for my whole year, just four pieces of wood. So I'm gonna go ahead and get that sealed while I'm waiting. And then I'll go ahead and seal my little pieces as well. I'm going to use a sanding disc between after I do my multi-purpose sealer. And you know, this is still a little bit cold, and cold means not dry yet. So I'll go ahead and get it sanded and allow it to dry a little bit further. One of the things I'm going to be putting this magnetic paint on over the top of this, and I've got to do a couple layers. I do not want my companies to clash, so this has to be dry before I do this. And you have to use a different roller head or a dry, cleaned roller head. Right, when you get ready to do your magnetic paint, it's going to come and it's going to be a little bit watery like this. You've got to stir it up. So I'm going to use my palette knife. I'm just going to spend a few minutes and get it all mixed up. Okay, I won't waste your time on camera doing this. But you definitely, all the filings, it's got real metal filings in here, and so they're all down here at the bottom. All right, so this is where it took me maybe about a minute. I've got it nice and runny and gooey. Okay, I think I'm pretty good. I'm going to put a pile out here. It actually doesn't take that much to coat. Put that out there, leave my palette knife off to the side. Yeah. Everybody going in the same direction. And then we're going to use our roller. I want a nice thin coat. I don't want anything real heavy. Okay. And you just apply an even coat. Just looks like a base coat. Nice and thin. And because we're going to have chalkboard over the top of this, we want to make sure that we're not lumpy. So do make sure that you take a little time sanding in between. Follow the manufacturer's recommendation. I think it's an hour drying time between each coat of paint. And thoroughly dry 24 hours before putting anything over the top of it. So real easy to do. You just need a little time in preparation. And just three coats at least. I would maybe go to three or four. Just to make sure you're super magnetic. And then you're good to start painting. All right, so we're going to use a great big 24-inch long tracing paper. I'm going to lay it out. See how big we need it. And then it tears nice and straight. So you just tear off a piece that's big enough for your project. And I love it because it does floor cloths. It's big enough to do your floor cloths in any size project, really, without taping a whole bunch of pieces. So I'll get my project laid on here, mark my hole so I know where I'm upright, and that's important. I'll show you why in just a second. This is really important. Like, say you wanted to adapt a pattern to a wreath. Well, you need to know how to be able to lay it out, and so it's nice to have that outline of the surface first. Then what I do is I go ahead and I tear off this extra piece. And now I have a wonderful piece of tracing paper for a future project. Okay. Now what I'm going to do, I've got my project printed out. It's sketched and done. And thank God for Dustin because he helps me with all these things. So I'm going to get this, decided my pumpkin needed to grow. I'll get this taped together. And what's nice is, okay, and I made one dot, but I didn't make two. That's okay because I can figure that out. Because of the scallops, and I know that that's the top, I can just line these up and fold it in half. And the half thing is really important. You could fold it in half the other way as well. What that gives you is it gives you true north. So I can jockey this thing around as I'm fitting my pattern on there, and I can get it exactly right. So you could tuck in, you know, say you wanted, you know, your pumpkin over here, and you, because you can see through it so well, you can just piece the pieces together, then you trace on top of it, and it makes an excellent layout tool. All right, I'm going to use the Americana chalkboard paint, and I did a big test. I really scoffed. I don't believe. I'm a big mocker when it comes to new products. And I did a test with the chalkboard paint, matte black paint, which is what I would have used to have used, and the chalkboard clear coating. And I've got to tell you, the chalkboard paint came in absolutely number one for its erasability and the niceness and way the chalk interfaced with the chalkboard paint. The clear coating did come in number two, and ding dang diddly, that black matte did not come in at a very high level. So the chalkboard paint is a really superior product when we're dealing with chalk and paint. So this came out really, really flat though, and very watery, so I think I need to shake, and I'll come back to you. All right, shaking it did its job. I'm going to use a roller to apply, and I'm just going to put on enough coat so that I get good coverage, and I'll allow it to dry. Okay, we're going to roll on our lamp black onto our wreath as well, and that's just going to be black from just the acrylic paint black, not the chalkboard black. Now, you know, on the chalkboard paint, you can use that on your walls, on your doors, inside your cabinet for family notes. Very versatile product. Okay, so I'm going to make all of my squares and my wreath black. And I'll have a couple companion pieces for fall. Okay, the next thing we want to do, we've got this nice and dry, is we'll re-roll on our black. And you know what? I think I want gloves. Okay, I've got my nitrile gloves on. They're latex-free. And you can use them and use them and use them. All right, and I'm going to re-wet this. And you know what? Before I'm re-wetting, I'm going to get out some paints because I suspect things can dry real quick here. Okay, we are using traditional burnt sienna, burnt orange, and traditional raw sienna. So we have to work wet and wet. Definitely have to have one coat dried on there before you do this technique, because it will lift off to the surface color underneath. And we don't want that. So get everybody nice and goobered up with some black here. Take our damp sea sponge, and we're going to dip it into the first color, which is the traditional burnt sienna. All right, and I'm going to work from the inside to the out because I want this to be kind of darker at the edge. So I'm going to pounce and I'm going to twist. I'm going to pick up a little bit more. Pounce and twist out towards my outer edge. And I don't want it to look spongy, so I definitely want to be twisting. And the biggest thing we have to deal with right now is glare. So I just need to twist it to an angle I can see it. And you can bring it out to that edge, just make sure it's really faint once you get out there. Okay, now a little bit of the burnt orange. It around on my sponge just a little bit. Get a little bit better view. Now, if you are doing this, what I'm just doing right now, just picking up my surface and holding it with gloves that might have paint on them, and something was painted on the back side, you would need to be very, very careful not to mess it up. What you can do is you can put a piece of the cling wrap, sandwich wrap stuff that you store your leftovers in the fridge with, on the back side, and that helps protect it. And then make sure, of course, that you varnish it. Okay, twisting. So this is the look that we've got so far. Now we're going to go into a little bit of the raw sienna, traditional raw sienna. Ooh, just a little bit less. Okay, I'm going to, running out of room on my palette, I'm just going to use my nonstick mat. Backwards one to the burnt sienna, the traditional burnt sienna. I want a little bit more orangey color in there. And I've kind of sucked it all off. Okay, now I'm going to walk around this outside edge and really fade it out, but I want to bring that out there to the edge so that there's not some kind of definitive line. And then I'm going to go with the clean side of my sponge and I'm going to blend it down real well. Do a little bit more twisting. And this, of course, will dry down much darker than it is. And I think that gives it a nice, warm, kind of brown look, but with some interesting stuff going on. All right. Okay, before I get started, I want to clean my mess up. These little pieces of paint and stuff can chip off and end up getting on your painting. So I want to make sure that I don't have a big mess. I'm squirting with water, and I'm using this little handy scraper. And all my paint will just come right off. So I'll clean this up, I'll dry it off, and then this is the Nonstick Craft Mat, and then I'll be ready to paint. Got my backgrounds all blocked in, so it's the stage you want to be at, and I've traced on my top lines so that I can see where to shade. Okay, we're going to shade to separate our leaves with milk chocolate. Okay, and so what I want to do is I'm going to use the curved flat brush, which is flat on one side and curved on the other. I'm going to make my float. Okay, so I'm going to come over here, I'm going to blend, blend, blend. Give it one little swipe the opposite way. Make sure I'm not dirty, I've blotted on my paper towel. Okay, now what I want to do is I want to make sure that I have separation between these leaves. So I'm going to go in, and we'll start up here in the corner. I'm going to go in and just float like normal. And I can draw it down to my tip right there. And that's normally where I'd have to leave it until it dried. But with the curved flat, because of the rounded back end, I can tickle and round and come up the other side. So now I've managed to do my whole float all at one time instead of having to wait for things to dry. So we'll come over, do the same thing here, except for this isn't. You always want to have your paint on the side that you lean to, like you want to be able to see your float. So if you're floating where you can't see the tip of your brush with the paint, then you need to reverse that. Okay, and I just keep rolling it around here. Now I'm floating with the other side of my brush, which is not quite as beautifully blended, so I'm going to just float that out just a little bit. Reload with water. Now, do you know the water drop technique? Okay, that's where you take your water and you just mist on your palette and get some bubbles of water. So I can pick up a drop of water. One drop too big. And I can just keep blending so I don't have to go back and wash my brush constantly. Okay, I'm not going to worry about getting anything on my little pumpkin poo here, and I'm floating backwards right now away from myself with my, I can't see it, but I feel like this is an easy float, so that's okay. So there's when to break the rule, right? Okay, so just everywhere where there's a leaf on top of something else, give it a nice crisp little edge, and then on some of those you might come in and blend them smoother. That way you have some good lines. So, did you see that when I just did that, I had this big swoopy looking shade? I don't want swoopy shades. I want pretty line shades. Okay, so, and then I want them separated by leaf. So I'm not going to float along that whole thing right there. I'm going to let that one dry. I'll come back to him. Okay. Now I've got this little hanging thing right here, so I want to take care of that right now. And smooth that in. Blot with my finger. Okay, so just on all of these things, you just want to shade right up next to it. Now the other thing you'll want to do is you want to shade with milk chocolate on the edges of turned things. And what I mean by that is where this leaf right here is turned over, that will show that it's bent and being flipped. Okay, so you want to shade against there. Same thing over here, where that's been shaded. Okay, so I'll come over here. And then we'll go ahead and shade on our squash right here as well. Shade to show that he's turning. We won't worry about that green. I do want to take out some of those chops. The nice thing about shading on a big area like this is I can go and extend my float with my dry rubbing technique. So I don't have to worry about getting all the way as big as I want. With one float. And when you see me chopping like this, what I'm doing is working that paint into my surface and moving it from my brush onto my surface. And right now I've got too dry a brush and too little paint, but I'm making it work anyway. Let's go down here and draw that out just a little bit. Okay, it gives us a little bit of form and shape. And I think that's all of my flipped edges. Now you'll want to go through and erase. Okay, so you'll go through, I've got a micro eraser here. You're going to go in and you want to take out any of these white lines that are left because they will mess with your eye. Alright, so we're going to just tuck in some russet shading here and there in these deep little divides here. Whoops. So just where this starts coming in here, and there's a pile of leaves. That's a good place. A little corner moment here. We're going to be doing some dry rubbing. I'm not worried about making floats be the prettiest thing. You know, that's one of the things I think that we get kind of tripped up with, is we think that every little float here has to be this perfect, stellar thing. I can float stellarly, but not everything has to be perfect, because when we do some of the top details, I guess the trick is to be able to tell the difference between when it needs to be perfect and when it doesn't. Okay, so let's see. Let's just keep moving around the piece. And just so I can get over here. All right, so this is obviously going to be one of those nice tucked dark corners. Okay, same thing here. Clean up with the back edge of your brush with that rounded edge. And so see how that variation, dark, lighter, dark, helps give a little bit more depth to your painting. Just makes it look less fake and less contrived, I think. Okay, we'll give this underneath part here a little chisel edge float. Maybe this high part right here. We will decide that this little guy down here could be a little bit more shadowed. So I'll tuck it along and then I'll widen it out. And then I'll stick my finger right in the middle of it. Perfect. Okay, now we'll take just a little bit of, I think I'm going to wait on the soft black until the end and see where I need stuff to be. Okay, next it's time to go ahead and dry rub. We need some of our crescent stencil brushes and dry paper towels. Now we're going to have three kinds of colors that we're going to be dealing with. And I think I'll use my, this is the 3/8 brush. We've got three kinds of colors. We're going to be doing reds, browns, oranges, and yellows. So right now what I want to do is put in some of my browns and my shading. So I'm going to use milk chocolate. That's going to be the biggest. While we've got these colors out on the palette, and I'll dry all of that off on the paper towel. And this is where I'm going to come out over here, get pretty close to my edge. Now I've got a faux finish back here, so I don't want to be too messy because that will make it very hard to patch my background. Okay, so we'll just get some of this tip going, and so that's why I switched down to this smaller brush. Now how will we make it cinch into the edge? That's when we'll float to do that. Okay, so now I've got that. This is going to use up a lot of paper towels, and just here and there on the piece, we could go and smooth out some of the shading on our little crook neck squash here. Draw that in. I got a little stripey on one side. So I could bring that and clean it up and bring it in a little bit deeper. Okay. Still in milk chocolate. Let's give this leaf just a little bit of brown, bringing the eye in. And these are going to be my little green guys. Get this one and down over here. You can make it be one-sided where it hasn't quite lost all the color yet. Go down next to our shading and even the tone out. Okay, and then we'll come over on this side. And we'll pick on a few of these, bring that color in, and maybe out here. It's got a little stripey right here. See how my corner is not quite cut? So we'll just round that out. Okay, much better. Same thing here. We can bring that shadowing forward just a little bit. Like the shading is good, but maybe we want it to come out further. Okay. Biggest thing is don't overdo this color, because this is going to be your this is your browns, and we really don't want a big wreath filled with brown leaves. Okay, now we're going to go into our russet color. And we'll deepen everywhere where we just did. Okay, just a little bit of a deep thing. Right there on the edge. Make sure you do it on the edge and let the other color show through. All right, next what we need to do is give our leaves a little bit of a yellow tint before we get too far with our shading and our colors. Okay, so I've got bright yellow, and we just want to give them just a good yellow glaze up the middle. Same on our squash. I can go right over my shading. That'll just help the colors meld together a little bit better. And this is where you'll start seeing things kind of pop to life. You can increase it, or you can keep it low. Your choice. If you don't like yellow, don't put a lot of yellow. Just continue like that through the piece. Okay, next we're going to do the orange sequence, and so we're going to pick up persimmon, and we're going to choose, you know, where do I want there to be orange coming into this leaf, and this is going to be our bigger orange color. Don't forget it can come around and sneak around in a couple places. It doesn't have to just follow like a little arm of the leaf. I feel like something's a little strange with this leaf. Okay, so just dry that off. Put that in. I might want to connect that right there. Bring this in far enough to be able to use your other colors on top. Okay, so we'll give it a little kiss of color over here. And squint at it, and we've got this orange pumpkin. We want to be able to carry our oranges through. So squint and make sure that you are getting a good carry color. We also have another odd color here, and that's the green. So we want to make sure that we are paying attention to balance of color. Okay, so I think where that little leaf pulls over, we'll make that be a color. Okay, and we'll just keep walking things around. We've got green to put in the leaves yet. We've got some floating to do. me squint at it, see if we like it. So see how we have this yellow part right here on top of this orange part. So let's bring that down like it's intentional. Like that way you can see that leaf on top of that leaf. So let's not make this orange because the other thing is. And now we can come back up and we'll go into Georgia clay. And then we're going to deepen next to edge, not bringing it out as far. You can bring that in some. Kiss of some color over here, and then just continue. Next we'll go into a little bit of country red, and that should tone us back just a little bit on our orangeness and make it move it into the red family. I'm using dirty brush so I don't have to keep changing my brushes, but I have to change them in between the colors. Red there. And then you notice that I'm not spending as much time on this color as well, because a little bit will go a long way. All right, I'm going to float with russet on the areas that I have made into the orange areas or the red areas. And that's just going to get me next to my leaf edge right there. Okay, so I don't see how I have a little halo going on right here. I don't want a halo. Okay, so everywhere where we decided that we needed to have that color. And I'm not trying to float it over that color, I'm just trying to put it right up next to that leaf edge. This is where your float needs to be a little bit prettier. So you want to make sure that you're not making fugly floats. There's a word. Okay, so clean up all those little edges. Oops, staying on the leaf. Alright, next we're going to use olive green. And we're going to put little kisses of olive green, or our greens, in our leaves. And we'll put this places where the other colors are not, and we're going to float next to the edge of our fear. Like that. Ooh, yeah, make sure you rub all the color off, otherwise you're going to have a big wet green spot. Colors is really strange. Some colors really, really, really stick when you put them down, and some colors don't. I'm not sure what the difference is. This color seems to have more oomph than some of the other colors do. Okay, so just going to repeat on the opposite side. Same technique, you're looking at the picture and you're saying, okay, look at, I see where there's colors coming out here. Okay. All right, now we'll go into Hauser Medium Green. And I'm going to wipe out some of that olive yellow and reload and re-dry off just to get a little bit more green feel. There we go. I'm getting a little bit off my leaves, so I'm going to take out a Q-tip, super pointy little swabs, detail swabs almost. I'm going to spit on my Q-tip and wipe off any fuzz that I get on the outside. Okay, and I'm going to repeat on the other side. Next, we're going to do evergreen. I'm going to use a sparing hand with the evergreen. It's going to tone down that glow that we've got going on right now. We'll just repeat over here on this side. Alright, it's time to play with our pumpkin. Right now my leaves are feeling a little bit electric, so I want to see what happens when I play with the pumpkin a little bit and see if that makes a difference. I'm going into persimmon, and I'm wondering if persimmon's going to be too light. We'll see. If it's chalky, then we'll stop and we'll rethink of that color. Okay, so I'm going to rub my highlight on, keeping it away from my edges, but not keeping it intentionally like away from my edges. I'm just trying to keep it more in the middle where a highlight would be. Once we bring up these colors, then that may be the difference that I need. Here. And then as soon as we get the sections, as soon as we get the sections on, then we'll erase these lines. Okay, and then I think I'll go ahead and repeat that with the same color. Just to bring that up just a little bit stronger. And I'll repeat it at the top instead of bringing it all the way down. A little bit of something going back there on our back sections. And then maybe just a dry brush moment where I'm not drying off all the paint, but letting it sit on top a little stronger. Okay, we're going to use Antique Gold Dirty Brush Loaded in our sections, not trying to cover everything else that I did up. A little bit more. It's getting nice and sectiony looking. It's bringing the color up so that our leaves are not sitting there around it being so bright. I think we'll go one more time. Going for just a little bit more of shine. Let's go take a dip into our bright yellow and see what happens when we do that. Just a little kiss there at the top, maybe a little bit more on the front section. Okay, yeah, I'm liking that better. Up goes the brush, right? And then we'll go into our red color, which is our country red. And then we'll glaze down at the bottom of the pumpkins. Kind of walk that in just a little bit. Dry and see what I get. I think we're definitely going to want some shading in our russet. I thought I could get by without shading by having that dark base color, but I don't think that's going to work so much. So we'll just come out and around, just to deepen the brim. Okay, we definitely need to do something back here. And I think we can almost just glaze that down brown. Okay. We can take our moon yellow and our round brush and just kind of dry brush. Flick on the paper towel. Just dry brush a little bit of a highlight. And that gives it a little bit more center of interest. Kind of sparkly stuff is going on there. Okay, we're going to focus on this stem right now. We're going to pick up with our round brush, show you the loading technique. I'm going to take our round brush and I'm going to just kind of load generously on both sides, and then I'm going to flatten my brush out, flick on my paper towel once, flip my piece over, and then I'm going to pull, and hopefully this won't be a screaming color, I'm going to pull little section-y colors. Making them kind of strong and stripey. Okay. Up through. Oops. Yep, like that. Screaming. I'm going to go back and we'll do the same thing here, our stem. Okay, then we'll take our curved flat, our soft black paint. And we'll shade at the base. We'll shade where it overlaps. And we're going to shade a little bit down the sides. I don't want it to get too deeply dark going on there. This guy back here could probably have a little bit of soft black shading, maybe even glazing back in the back. Maybe even towards the stem. Indicating sinking into the stem end there. Okay. Now, my red down here isn't showing up very much, so I'm going to go ahead and go with a little bit of the soft black just to deepen the base. And I won't deepen the base every place. And I won't continue to sound like the Cat in the Hat. Okay, and I think, whoops, that gets us just a little bit, so maybe a little bit more every place than I thought I was. A little bit more anchoring. Now, I think one of the things that's bugging me is I have two colors of orange going on here. I've got the orange that I base my pumpkin in, and I've got the orange that I've got on my leaves, and they're not the same. I'm going to go back into the, I think it's traditional burnt sienna, and I'm going to go back and I'm going to try toning back my orange just a little bit. Give it a little veiled tint. Now what it will also do is make my leaves darker, and I'm not certain that that's the direction I want to go. We're going to go ahead and do the squash right here. I'm going to use some of my antique gold. And we'll dry rub up the center of the squash neck. We'll pop that one more time. And now dirty brush, I'm going to go into the Hauser medium green, and I'll do it one more time. That will neutralize the color in my paintbrush. Okay, and we're going to go back and forth in the middle here across this yellow-green divide and just kind of erase the fact that there's a divide there. Bring it down into our squashy area. And we can bring that up into the yellow and down into the green. Just kind of blurring that line. Okay, then we're going to go into our olive green dirty brush. And we're just going to give it, a very strong. I'm going to give it a little bit of those kind of colored lines going up. I think that'll do it. Okay, and I think I'm going to go, you heard me say it before, but this something's bugging me, and the way you get rid of things is you go back one step. So I'm going to go back to my cocoa color, which was my base coat on my leaves, and I'm going to tone down a little bit of my greens. Just going to back them down with a little bit of makeup. Okay, and see if that makes me happier. Something's not making me happy. And I think it might be the green. So I can have a hint of green, but maybe not so neon. Okay, when you say neon, you have to make that noise. All right, we'll back that guy down. And you can blend over, like if I've got red and green in one area, I could blend over both. And notice I'm not getting rid of it, I'm just backing it down. So maybe I decide that this is maybe just a touch too inferno-y. I go back that puppy down. And it won't erase it, it will just give it a little makeup. Hey, this guy over here really got out of control. Okay, so that, just see how what that did there? That just did everything I needed it to do. It's not how good you paint, it's how many fixes you know. Take lots of classes from people who are not afraid to mess stuff up and then teach you how to fix it. Okay, we'll come over here. Tone that guy down. Hello, my name is Neon Green. Okay, that's making me much happier. Still maybe a little bit orange. I think we'll see. We'll see what happens. Along for the ride on this one. Actually, I think I know exactly what needs to happen. I think what's happening is I'm having an argument with my two colors here. So what we're going to do is we're going to argue back. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my orange that is in my leaves and stuff, and I'm going to bring it into my pumpkin. Okay, so that is the, right now I have persimmon. Okay, we're going to brighten up and pop a pumpkin here. I'm going to orangeify him. So we'll make him up the opposite way. We'll make him a stronger color where we knocked the other sections down. Yeah, that's making me happier. We could give a little kiss of some orange over here into our squash neck. Just because he's in the family of orangeness going on right here. Okay, I think that's good. All right, we're gonna line our wheat with milk chocolate. Oops. A little straighter would be great. Get into our lettering. Have some stay low, some stay high. Okay, then we're going to put you over there. Yeah, I was the right way, the other way. Here we go. We're going to just take and put our brush down and kind of let it flick out. If you do a quick little pull up, then you'll get some awesome little tendrily things that are wheat-esque. It's almost like a little arrow that we're building. Some high, some low. Okay, we'll repeat on the other side, then we're going to highlight that with a little bit of our cocoa in the mix. So we can bring just a little bit of a highlight to the front. And then we'll give it those little wheat hair things. Okay, same thing here, and then of course rinse and repeat. All right, now it is time to add some veins to our project. I'll just draw out the little leafy veins. Let's see, that it figure out which way this little guy is bending. Okay, and some of them can have a couple of things coming off the side. We need to give this little guy a stem as well. Okay, this guy's all hidden. Over, you know, just a little hint of something there. You could use a few more. Okay. All right, I want to put some metallic powder paint here. Here's what we do. To make it into a paint, we take our metallic powders, that's brass, and a little bit of copper, I think. I've used it before in that combination. I'll just put them out there, and then I'm going to take a little bit of a clear medium. You can mix it with any kind of clear medium. I'm going to use some clear matte varnish, put some matte varnish out. And then we're going to mix our metal powders into the varnish. Okay, and magically, you have the shiniest, awesomest metal ever. Pull in just a little bit of our copper. So I don't want it to scream brass, you know. warm it up just a little bit. Okay, just perfect. You can thin that with water if you need to make it flow better. What I love about the metal powders, there's 8 different colors and you can mix them all together. All right, now I want to put the metal powders on this outside rim. Let's go out here. I think I want some on the outside and inside. So we're going to take our compass, and it's already set just at closed. I think it's at a good space. Take my line all the way around. Make sure you keep it angled at the same angle, so you're going to have to turn your piece to do it. This is the fastest way ever. Now you can tape it with stretchy tape, but in this case today, I think I'm going to try not taping mine because I have these scallops to help me. And I'll show you what I mean. Okay, so I'm going to load some of the metal mix into my brush. I'm going to thin it with some water. Twist my brush. Get myself a nice little point. Okay, we'll start over here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go only like halfway. I'm going to start here, give myself a running start, and only go to my corners. Then I'll flip it over, and I'll do the exact same thing on the other side. Now the reason this is easier is because you can do one stroke with your hand and make it nice, but if you try doing it all the way along, it's going to be harder to do. Okay. Now there is a way, let me see if I thin myself down, to do this actually, where you can plunk. Let's try it. Okay, if I fail, then oh well. Right? So you just get your hand. Oops, I gotta press a little harder. Get your hand. And that is using your finger as like a little guide point compass. Okay, so that's how you can do it. Just going from corner to corner and not necessarily completing everything makes it much easier to do. All right, for our words, we're going to do thinned milk chocolate. Sorry, fighting with my paint. I'm painting on my palette upside down because I flipped it for more room and now all my paints are accessed from the wrong side. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to use a calligraphy type technique, which means that we're just simply going to press harder on one side than the other. Okay, so I've got my brush loaded. Reload, because I used it all up. Okay, so that'll be our fat or thicker side. And we'll make all of our that sides be the thick sides. All the left sides. Okay, and I guess we can have this cross beam be. So we'll just continue to line. Okay, we're going to add drop shadow to the, let me dry off my handle. Let's see, we'll add drop shadow to the this side. So to the left sides. It's not going to show up as much as it would because we have such a almost black background, but it'll add a little bit of depth. Keep your paint thin.
sure you switch sides when you get down to that.
Now we need to highlight the top of it, and so we'll use cocoa to highlight the top, and then we're going to embellish it the gold, the metallics. So by using this color, it's going to make everything really uniform. And bring the colors all the way around. Okay, and now we want to go in on top of that with our metallic, which is going to give us some reflection and depth. It's kind of sheer, so it'll pick up the colors underneath. It'll add some richness for certain. I love these metal powders. You can make them as dense as you want so that they will actually base coat in just one coat. I can make them sheer so that they're layering, and as in this case. You can mix them together. They're an indispensable. I cannot even think what I did without them until I discovered them. Okay, so that gives us our little glitz. Now it is time to add the total glitz, which is to totally spatter to bring everything together. This is going to be the paints on our palette. I need a heavy-handled brush, thinned paint on our palette. So I've got thin milk chocolate first. Tap off everything I can. Now I'm going to go in these areas where I've got these little wheats. They kind of stand a little bit stiff like they are right now, so I need to make them be more family members, and the spatters will help do that. Oops, down here we could use a little, pretend like there's wheats coming out. So it's pretty heavy spatters. So that brings some up there as well. Okay. You have a couple of extra spatters. Now we'll pick up the cocoa and make it a little bit thicker than it was. Okay, and that is going to our magic dust on the pumpkins. We'll put some on the ends of our leaves. I think this would be a very good project without spattering. Okay, and then we add some spatters to the tips of the leaves where the lightest color is. Okay, And then finally we go into our gold and we thin it. And we're going to add little gold speckles to our wreaths. And a great big freckle to our squash. That's what Q-tips are for. And then down here on our hunky. All right, and then I think we can add some black spatters as well. Outer edge. Okay, liking it. I have berries drawn in, but I think I'm going to leave the berries off because I think I decided that red was not going to be my companion color on this one as much. So I think we have a very good, I think it's an awesome little project. All right, we're going to shade here and there on our leaves, on our edges, because we don't have anything stacked on top of each other. We're just going to make some little brown areas and some, and just go ahead and shade some areas. Maybe we want this corner to be shaded. We can mop if we desire. If that's going to be sticking right out in the middle of the leaf, then mopping is a good idea. You can mop to clean up your edges. And then just mop onto your paper towel to clean anything off of your brush. Okay, so we'll go reload. And we're going to just give a little kiss here and there. I think I'm going to do most of the work with without floating, and I'll do it more with the dry rubbing, which is a very effective way to do this technique. Get some down on here at the bottom. Okay, now we'll pick up our dry rubbing brushes, which are at this point fairly crusty with paint, and those of you who have watched these videos will know that I will just lean on my brush cleaner and restorer to fix my brushes up. Okay, and we're going to just dry rub the bright yellow up the middle of our leaf, just to perk them up and give them a little bit of that drama color that leaves have in the fall. Alright, so we'll just do all three of these leaves exactly the same way with the yellow up the middle, and I can strengthen that if I want. I don't think it's enough. They all get the same treatment. Okay, so we're going to start with persimmon on our leaves, the same as our wreath. And we're going to start deciding where we want some color. And I think I've decided that this is the position my leaves are going to be on my board. So, and on this I can be messy, because I can just take my black and just base out any dust that I get on there. And that's a little bit easier than having to float up next to everything. So I like this kind of plain background a little bit better. You can go in and out over the top of your yellow color, so don't worry about that. And just reload your brush as you need to. Okay, so I have that there, so now I know I'll probably want
a little bit of my orange over here on this side. Maybe kiss some over here. Maybe coming up into that color. Look at the flow of colors. I have a little bit over here, a little bit up here and over. Let's see if our areas are big enough. Now I can go into my Georgia clay, and that's going to be a stronger orange color. And this I want to just have sit back from the edge of the color I just did. So we're strengthening it, but we're not letting it take over the whole thing. And it's really amazing how fast this color goes, like it takes over. Okay, little teeny bit of country red. Just a little bit tucked here and there. And now I'll switch brushes. I'll pop that one in the water. I'll switch brushes and we'll apply just a little bit of our green. Now the green is where you can get into trouble. I may start with the Hauser green. Olive is where the start should be. But we want to be really, really careful. I'm going to try Hauser first and see if it's not too shocking. Yeah, maybe a little olive is going to be good. Just maybe not too big. Then into Hauser medium, dirty brush. It's so much faster to do this without having to be careful of your edges. This is really, really rather nice. Okay, so we'll go into Evergreen. In that color, and we want to make sure we're not wet so it's not grabbing. Okay, I think we can ditch that brush, and then we'll get into our Raphael and some Russet, and that is going to be our veins. And we'll thin that with water. Okay, and dry our ferrule off. And we're going to pull towards ourselves from the vein. Because you're going to get a really good graduated line that way. And I keep them pretty simple. It doesn't need to be the star attraction. If you want to take extra time, you can certainly do extra veining. Have them fade off. And if you get a little wiggly guy, go back and fix it and then blot it.
Okay, and then I'm going to go ahead and fix my black before I do anything else. So I'll just take a round brush, a little bit of lamp black, and then fix any little hairy fluffs that I got from dry rubbing over the black. Okay, now that I've got that patched, I'm going to come over here with my russet and make a nice little stem with pretty strong looking russet.
Okay, and you want it to flow naturally.
We're going to spatter using the White Wonder Rake brush. And that is not the White Wonder Rake brush. There it is. I'm at this point of the project where I have 59 brushes in my bucket. Okay, so what we want to do is we want to spatter a little bit of the colors at the tips of the leaves. We need some cocoa out because that's our base color. And cocoa's about bit the dust here. We thin everything with water. And we spatter it all off on our paper towel. Use something heavy-handed. I've got a palette knife. And anchor, and it'll allow you to just dribble little spots exactly where you want them. Also, my brush is, my angle, instead of being way up high and I'm doing like snow, my angle is way down low. Okay, so we get a couple of little spatters out there. And it starts just making it look a little bit magical, like there's been a little color explosion. Probably a little bit more over here. Okay. And I think, let's see, let's go and spatter in a little bit of our lamp black. And then I think maybe with a little bit of our Georgia clay on our red bits. Okay, I think we'll let that dry. Okay, I am getting all my stuff positioned so that I can get my word up here. Here is my big evil plan. Let's see if I can find my other piece. Okay, here's how we're making this into a perpetual chalkboard. Okay, we have a piece that is cut approximately as wide as I've got my my knobs spaced out, okay? So that when I take these guys off, I'll just put them up here. Okay, when I take those guys off, I could also put a bigger piece there and put it in the same position using the same position of the Velcro. Okay, so that's what I'm trying to figure out right now, is what that position will be, so that I've got my knobs for keys. Oops, can you even see that? I don't think so. Ah, get down there. Okay, so I've got my knobs for keys that will stay there all the time. But then this piece, these pieces will come off with Velcro. I could put Easter eggs here. I could put I could just put whatever, flowers, spring, summer, fall, Halloween, whatever. It just frustrates me to have a big piece like this and have it only serve one season. So with our word notes up here, we'll have plenty of room for making all kinds of notes. We've got a magnet chalkboard, so you can stick magnet notes on here as well. You could make some cute little leaf magnets and stuff like that. So, I mean, there's so many variations. So that's what I'm deciding right now. These are going to get hot glued, and these guys are getting a piece of Velcro behind it. So as soon as I got everything positioned, then I'll bring you back and show you how it all works. Okay, as I'm putting my piece together, what I've done is I've got my Velcro off to one side on the end pieces. Got my marks so I know where I'm putting things down. I've got it right in the middle on this. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to apply the other part of my Velcro to the back side of that. And you could do this in reverse too. You could have your Velcro down here, which is what's going to happen here. And when you replace the piece, put the pieces with the sticky side up and then press your piece over the top. And then your Velcro will be perfectly aligned. Alright, I'm getting ready to make my metal powder. So I've got some matte varnish. You could use gloss as well. And I'm going to mix it into my gold metal powders with just a little bit of copper as well. This tones it down just a little bit. You can make these as dense as you want to make them base coat right away, or you can make it very sheer. You can add water. There's all kinds of stuff you can do with them. You can mix any of the metal powder colors together, and you can mix them in with paint to create a kind of luster. So you really can have fun with these. They're just as versatile as you want to make them. Okay, so we're going to just line on our notes word. So just base it in. And take it in several steps. If you run out of liquid, don't worry about it and just go back and redo your line. I haven't added any water to this because I want it to base coat. So I'm having to do it just a little bit slower than I normally would. Look at the shine that you get with that though. Isn't that beautiful? And I think you get the idea, so I won't bore you to death. I'm going to tape this line over here, and I'll bring you back to show you how I get a nice, clean, taped line. All right, I'm going to take some green stretchy tape, and I'm going to apply it to my marked line. I'm going to apply a second line. Just a nice, thin, little graceful band, just to carry that from the top to the bottom. Ooh, not so thin. Okay. Press it down. Pull out an ink sweeper. Pat it in your gold. And I got wider at the bottom. Question is, do I want to go all the way from the top to the bottom? And I don't think I do. Well, maybe I do. Let's start right here. And you just pat it on straight up and down. And because it's an ink sweeper, it just covers so much ground. This makes light, light work. And it's base coating in one coat. Before my knobs were on. Now, do we go all the way up or not? Yeah, let's do it. You can always black it out if it stinks. Okay, we immediately peel our tape for an absolutely perfectly taped line. And the reason that that's perfect is not because of the applicator. It is because of the ink sweeper. The ink sweeper allows you just to go straight up and down in big movements, and it just bases and does it all in one movement.